Hello, safety pilot. What are you working on?
Hi, shield pilot. I'm working on the FDM data for landings over the past 2 years. It looks fine, but look at this. The number of landings with vertical acceleration between 1.4 and 1.6 G is increasing. I think I will issue a memo reminding the pilots to aim for softer landings.
Hold on, Captain. Maybe that won't be necessary.
Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnar Nordahl and I am an ATR captain and instructor. In this video, I will be talking about the Flight Data Monitoring Program, FDM, also known as Flight Operational Quality Assurance, FOQA, Flight Data Analysis, FDA, SMS Data Monitoring, and the Trend Monitoring Program, to name a few. So what exactly is FDM? Essentially, it is the routine collection and analysis of flight data to provide objective and predictive insights aimed at enhancing safety. FDM is the gear that drives standardization of flight operations, and it is lubricated by just culture to foster trust and collaboration between management and flight crews. When used correctly, FDM significantly improves the quality of flight operations. However, if misapplied, it can have the opposite effect. In practice, an FDM program involves the following. 1. Continuously recording flight parameters throughout the flight. 2. Routinely collecting this data from aircraft. And 3. Using specialized software to analyze the recordings and extract safety critical information, such as deviation from operating procedures or abnormal parameter values. These parameters include deviations in airspeed, flight path, configuration, and more. When a threshold is exceeded, the analysis software triggers an alert, categorized as yellow, amber, or red, depending on the severity. A well-implemented FDM program offers several key benefits. Detect trends in operations that could negatively impact safety, even before they led to serious incidents. Capture safety-relevant events during flight, even if the flight crew didn't report them. Create a comprehensive and accurate picture of safety risks, which is essential for a robust safety management system, SMS. Verify the effectiveness of correcting actions, such as training, procedure changes, or equipment retrofits, and many other safety-related applications. Additionally, the flight parameters collected for FDM purposes can also be used for other operational benefits, such as maintenance schedule and fuel efficiency. However, FDM programs are developed for aircraft with a gross weight over 27 tons. That means they were initially developed for jet aircraft. As a result, FDM tools need to be specifically adopted for turboprop operations, which often fly into airports without published instrument approach procedures. A decade ago, more than 50% of ATR operators had not properly adjusted their FDM settings, meaning their generated reports were ineffective for flight safety programs. While the situation has improved since then, there may still be some operators who have not yet implemented a suitable FDM program. However, this will soon change, as from 2027, the FDM program will become mandatory for aircraft with a gross weight over 15 tons. One example illustrating the importance of proper FDM adjustment involves Fiji Link, which operates a fleet of Viking Twin Otter 400. When they implemented FDM, the system generated multiple red flags for excessive pitch-up after liftoff. This was due to the fact that, when lightly loaded, the Twin Otter requires a steep climb after takeoff to prevent from exceeding the flap speed limit. After adjusting the FDM parameters to better reflect the operational characteristics of the aircraft, the alerts were eliminated. A key factor in the success of an effective FDM program is the establishment of a strong just culture. A just culture fosters a fair and open environment where individuals feel safe to report errors or safety concerns without the fear of unjust punishment. It draws a clear line between honest mistakes and reckless behavior, focusing on learning and improving systems rather than assigning blame. One company that exemplifies a positive just culture is Bangkok Airways, where I flew for several years until the COVID-19 pandemic disrupted operations. Whenever a parameter was exceeded, or we suspected they were exceeded, we were encouraged to file a self-report, and there were no further consequences as long as the issue was acknowledged. However, if we failed to submit a report, we would be asked to meet with the flight safety officer. For example, during my first approach into Mahang Son in northern Thailand, I exceeded a descent rate of 1,000 feet per minute on final approach. A couple of weeks later, I was invited to the flight safety officer. During our meeting, I learned that runway 11 at Mahang Son has a 1% uphill slope. This gives the impression that you're higher than you actually are. When passing the final approach fix, we are just slightly above the puppy, and a vertical speed of 800 feet per minute would have been enough to bring me down to the puppy well before reaching the runway. This kind of constructive feedback, rather than punitive measures, is what allows pilots to learn and improve safety practices. In addition to a strong just culture, it's crucial for the company to have qualified personnel with specific FDM training. During the 2016 Regional Flight Safety Conference, Leopold Sartorius, FDM expert at ATR Flight Operations Support, shared the following example.
And the third point is in terms of analysis skills within the airlines. I will go through an example that shows how difficult it is sometimes to interpret data. Here we have the data from May to December of 1 year, and afterwards from January to August the year after. So each column is 1 year. The y-axis is the percentage of flight for which the touchdown occurred at a vertical G comprised between 1.4 and 1.6 G. It's no hard landing, be reassured. Fine, it's a, that's nice. But you can see, well, quite increasing. Is it good? Is it bad? Generally, the first reaction is, ooh, increasing, not good. But let's look more in details. Here you have the repartition of the vertical G at landing for all flights between May and August the first year. You can clearly see a bit below G, which is soft. It's soft. As I like it, I can tell that's very nice. And you can see a little of data, yellow range. Same, but the 1 year, then what can you see? The peak at 1.2 G has decreased. It's quite visible. And the data is more or less spread to higher G values. So basically, when you compare the two, you can see, in fact, that there was a move from low G landings to higher landings. Hence an increase in the yellow events, the trend. So the question is, it bad, is it good? In fact, that's pretty good. It's pretty good. Why? Because the low G touchdowns were indicated very soft landings, kiss landings, breeze landings, whatever you call it. And what's the most adverse consequence of those landings is high flare distance, generally high energy, in fact. And that's why that approach with higher performed kiss landings, it's easier when you have. Therefore, the positive such drift, less kiss landings, and shorter landing distances. All good. Of course, and someone was mentioning that this morning, of course you need to keep monitoring to make sure it does not drift too far towards hard landing area. But that's what FDM is done for. You solve an issue on the one hand, and you need to monitor, does not disturb the rest. That's the whole point.
To paraphrase his point, a soft landing often results from excessive speed, delayed power reduction during the flare, and an extended flare, all of which increases the landing distance. For me, A 1.2G landing feels soft. 1.3G is very good. 1.4G is solid. And 1.5G is on the firm side, but still perfectly acceptable. And that is all for this time. Thank you to Leopold Sartorius at ATR for sharing your expertise. And as always, a big shout out to our members of the channel. They watched this video 2 days before you. Thank you for watching, have a wonderful day, and happy landing.